Welcome to Design Standup, Episode 8, The State of UX in 2019, Part 2, by Fabricio Teixeira and Caio Braga of UX Collective. And I'm your host, Ryan Stone, reading to you every Tuesday and Thursday from the best blogs in the design industry, with their permission, of course. It's kind of like a free ongoing audiobook, always being updated with new content from your favorite designers. Whether you are a seasoned design professional or simply a design enthusiast, I am on a mission to help grow your knowledge in all things digital design. In today's episode, we continue where we left off in part one with Fabricio and Cal of UX Collective. So without further ado, let's stand up. The State of UX in 2019, Part 2, by Fabricio Teixeira and Cal Braga of UX Collective. Number 4, Designing for Less. For years, we've been designing with engagement as our key metric. Get people in, get people back. Get people to use our product as much as possible, several times a day. Now, as users, we're starting to feel the effects of having our attention kidnapped by too many services, and companies are feeling the backlash of seeing engagement decrease. How do we design with healthier behaviors in mind? Aggressive KPIs, short deadlines, bonuses that are tied to performance and to higher engagement metrics. The sad reality of the corporate world has forced designers to come up with new ways of engaging our audience. We have become really good at accelerating engagement. As an industry, we have created incredibly refined frameworks that try to explain the science behind engaging products. We have defied products like Instagram or Tinder for their unashamedly addictive qualities. We have learned and taught each other how to design for addiction, always thinking of reasons for people to come back to our product begging for more. The engagement pendulum has gone all the way to one side. It's now starting to swing back. Users are starting to feel the effects of years of addictive digital behaviors, from 33% of divorced couples citing Facebook as a reason for their split, to gamers who die of starvation after binge playing for several consecutive days, to more extreme cases like the YouTube campus shooter who is allegedly angry at the company's monetization policies. Companies are getting a lot of pushback and being questioned about their responsibility in this behavior shift. Society is awakening to the need of establishing a more mindful relationship with technology. It is a potent public health topic now. In 2018, we have seen a few companies move towards healthier experiences, or at least they're advertising that they do so. Apple's iOS 12 has introduced new features that reduce interruptions and give users a more transparent view of how they are spending their time on their iPhones, and so have YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. A few more examples, Google Inbox, RIP, and Gmail allow users to snooze emails for later. Bumble allows users to pause dating to take a digital detox. Google has launched an entire program for well-being across products. Instagram notifies users when they are all caught up to avoid endless feed scrolling. While these may seem like a lot of work, they are actually quite easy to do. These relatively small changes are incredibly powerful in how they impact society. UX is not only about the times when people are using our products, but also about the times when they are not. In the era of ever-vibrating smartphones and increasingly demanding apps, there is no better user experience than peace of mind. Amber Case's recent book on calm tech, inspired by 1995 Mark Weiser's paper, Designing Calm Technology, and covered in our 2017 report, outlines a few principles for how technology should be mindful of its impact in the user's life. 1. Technology should inform and create calm. 2. Technology should make use of the periphery. 3. Technology should amplify the best of technology and the best of humanity. 4. Technology can communicate but doesn't need to speak. 5. Technology should work even when it fails. 6. The right amount of technology is the minimum needed to solve the problem. And 7. Technology should respect social norms. With great power comes great responsibility. As designers, we have both the power and the responsibility to implement these principles. The same way we take pride in limiting our red meat consumption to avoid cardiovascular diseases and protect the world resources, or campaign against smoking, designers can be the ones advocating for healthier UX. We are the ones who can push back next time someone proposes to add infinite scroll to a social feed, or videos that autoplay, or pop-up forms. Since we are equipped with research-proven user insights, we are the ones who have the power to push for business metrics that are not measured in old-school standards, like views, pages per visit, or dwell time. We are the ones who call out a growth hacking idea for what it really is, a vicious cop-out solution. We are the ones who can help our teams choose better metrics. This trend of people wanting products and services that fulfill their needs while respecting their time will only accelerate in 2019. Instead of fighting for attention, the products we design should be striving for relevance and comfort. Our KPIs will start to shift from engagement-centered metrics to affinity-related ones. Ultimately, our metric will become making sure users themselves are achieving their own personal KPIs, not because we are benevolent gods, but because it's part of our job, and because users will demand so. Number 5. Our obsession with design methods. Google has made us lazy. How to make a diary study. When to use a hamburger menu. Persona template PDF. A few searches later, we find ourselves following a step-by-step guide created by somebody else, and, just like that, we forget the critical thinking aspect of our job. In the past few years, design has become more accessible to more people. Design firms like IDEO, Frog, and Cooper have done an outstanding job standardizing and popularizing certain design methods. Companies with strong design teams like Google, Airbnb, and IBM have done a similar effort elaborating and sharing design systems, workflows, libraries, and best practices. More and more, we rely on these resources we have available to jumpstart any project. The issue is that companies are competing for those same search terms, creating formulaic solutions in exchange for a second of your attention. We trust them more than we should. After all, it's hard to say no to a solution that's free and easy to implement. While predefined methods can be a great starting point, they can't be the end. For every article defending a method, there are 3 going against it. Which one will you believe? Can you apply the same method for every single project? Can you simply copy a competitor and call it a day? Pressed to deliver answers to our teams and keep the project running, we resort to canned design methods and forget the analytical, creative part of our jobs. As an industry, we have become obsessed with our design methods. Some designers are so addicted to following the specific set of steps outlined in a playbook or filling out a persona template that they found online that they forget to reflect on why they are using that method in the first place. That extreme focus on output rather than outcome can be extremely dangerous to design as a profession, creating a whole generation of designers who always have to be told what to do next. The impact on research. Research is a step of the process that suffers the most from canned methodologies. Being restrictive about a specific research method can also impact how much empathy you have for your users and your team. By forcing everything to fit a certain box, we miss nuances and opportunities to approach things differently and learn about the diversity of users, scenarios, and contexts we should be designing for. By being inflexible in our process, we lose our team's trust and make our day-to-day a burden rather than a collaborative learning experience. By neglecting to think critically about what we are doing, we are only feeding pre-existing bias behind our actions and way of thinking. We should be thinking more about methodologies rather than methods. We must understand what questions we need to ask instead of starting from the answers we want. As Joe Munko, User Research Director at Microsoft, insightfully states in his article, "Skip User Research Unless You're Doing It Right, Seriously," timeless research is really about building long-term organizational knowledge and curating what you've already learned. In 2019, we should not let our obsession with methods replace our inability to analyze and critically think about our work. Design is about solving problems, and deciding how to solve a problem is the first design problem to be solved. Number 6. Should design tools code? Every couple of weeks, we see a new article come up that tries to answer the good old question, should designers learn to code? Our industry is finally reaching a point where we are able to step back and reframe that question altogether. There are 2 fundamental arguments used by those who defend the fact that designers who learn to code become more valuable than others. First, by creating prototypes that are as close as possible to the ultimate intent of the desired experience, it becomes more likely that it will be executed by others appropriately, if not by the designer itself. Second, the more a designer can speak the language of their developer peers, the better they can collaborate to get to a stronger final product. Of course, designers should know how to code. This is about being a good artisan and knowing the materials you're dealing with. Of course, designers shouldn't spend all day creating code. This is as inefficient as asking an architect to build a wall herself. However, it turns out we were asking the wrong question all along. As Dave Maloff points out in To Code or Not to Code, OMG, this is totally the wrong question. While both of these arguments are truisms and irrefutable in their framing, they also continue to ignore all of the data that suggests that there are consequences to these truths, creating a unique paradox of logic. Relying on designers being able to code can be a symptom of systematic oppression in the workplace. Moloff states, "As a designer, I will go out of my way to speak the language of those who hold power, to assimilate, so they will understand me, so they will trust me. At the heart of this contradiction is the foundation of anthropology and the notion of balancing the outsider and insider perspectives to bring understanding through comparison. I am only as valuable as a designer as I am able to maintain that balance between the outsider and insider perspectives and to hold the mindset of student/apprentice. In parallel to this never-ending discussion, we have been observing an ongoing evolution of the design tools we use every day that enable designers to go back to focusing on what they are really good at, designing. Big surprise. In 2018, we have seen a few transformations that corroborate that trend. Principle has become one of the most powerful UI prototyping tools, requiring almost zero knowledge of coding and native coding languages. Companies like Airbnb have developed internal workflows that allow designers to sketch a UI on paper and spit out code in a matter of seconds, bridging the gap between designers and engineers working on design systems at scale. New tools like Framer X and modules have evolved to be able to automatically translate UI patterns into React components, which means in most cases developers can build upon designs instead of replicating them in production. Tools like Hadron App have started to unify design and dev workflows into a single UI that has two distinct views. Our tools shape the way we work. While knowing how to code certainly helps designers ensure they are coming up with technically feasible interfaces, there is a new wave of tools that are gradually taking on the responsibility of making designers think in terms of components and design systems. Design tools that are focusing on the design-dev collaboration have a competitive advantage over the ones that are solely focusing on fancy animations and gimmicks, or other things that will only benefit the designer-designer please like my dribble shot need for validation. In 2019, we will see more instances of design tools that know how to code. Designers putting machines to work for them, as opposed to having to learn an entirely new discipline that is foreign to their craft. It will also be the year when we stop thinking in terms of dev handoff and start thinking in terms of integrated workflows. Number 7. Hear that in part 3. You just listened to the post titled The State of UX in 2019, part 2 by Fabricio Teixeira and Cal Braga of UX Collective. If you want to learn more about Fabricio and Cal and read some of their other amazing articles on design, just press the link in the show notes or head over to UX Collective at uxdesign.cc. You can also access this full episode, along with others, at designstandup.com. Oh, and before you go, don't forget to check out the brand new Design Standup workspace on Slack, where we chat about the latest episodes, give and receive feedback on each other's most recent work, learn about new design tools, and much more. You can find an invite link in the show notes below, as well as direct channel links to the categories we discussed in today's episode. You can also sign up directly at designstandup.slack.com. Well, that's all I have for you today, guys. It's been a pleasure. Until next time, fill up those coffees, turn up those tunes, and let's design a better world.